สวัสดีค่ะ In this video, we will learn about bonding in coordination compounds. Before we start, let's get back to general chemistry 1 a little bit on chemical bonding. The chemical bonding, as we all know, are three types like ionic bond, covalent bond, and metallic bond. The different types of bonding here are because of the electrons on how they are used in bonding. For the ionic bonding, the electrons are transferred from metal atoms to non-metal atoms. For the covalent bonding, the bond between non-metal atoms are created by the share of electrons from both atoms, where the bonding between metal in the crystal of metal like sodium or potassium are from the electron pulling together to become electron C, right? When we want to see the structure or the explanation of how electrons are shared, we would look at the Lewis structure or the valence shell electron pair repulsion and explain the bonding by valence bond theory. If you can remember, this is all about hybridization, as you see here, sp, sp2, sp3, etc. For this chapter, we learn about coordination compound, which of course the bonding occur by coordinate covalent bond. In this complex or complex ion, as we learned last time, that the bonding occur between the metal and ligand. So metal and ligand, but the bonding is not a simple covalent bond. The difference is metal do not have electron, where ligand would bring both electrons to share, or these electrons are shared between the two atoms. And this is why the name is coordinate. All right, the bonding is not ionic and is not simple covalent. Okay, the explanation on how electrons are used, which hybridization would occur in this metal ion, can be explained using the same theory, valence bond theory. So you would think of the structure linear of complex. The metal would have sp hybridization. If the complex has structure as tetrahedral, the metal would have sp3 hybridization. If the complex has the shape of octahedral, the hybridization in the metal would be sp3d2. This went quite well for many complex ion or coordination compound. However, there is still unanswered question. For example, this octahedral complex, right? The hexa-aqua iron 2 and hexa-cyanoferrate 2, they both have the metal ion as Fe with oxidation number 2. They also have the same coordination number 6. Okay, but what happened is the first complex ion has paramagnetic property. The second complex ion is diamagnetic. We learn that paramagnetic or diamagnetic relate to the number of unpaired electrons. Now, let's look at how the electron of the metal ion would be different. The two complex ions have coordination number equal to 6, which means the shape of this complex ion would be octahedral. Okay. The valence bond theory or hybridization of the metal ion must be sp3d2. Now, how would we explain about magnetic property? We will look at the electron configuration of the metal ion itself. Metal ion here, Fe2+. The electron configuration would be argon 3d6. The crystal field theory was suggested. Okay, having said the introduction for a very long time, the coordination compound bonding between metal and ligand are best explained by this crystal field theory. Okay. Hope you are still with me. The crystal field model here focus on the energy of d orbitals, the energy of d orbitals. Remember that we have how many orbitals? Huh? Five orbitals. And this model assumes that the ligand and metal, the bonding here with between ligand and metal is entirely ionic, which means it think of ligand as a negative charge, metal as a positive charge. So if you think of the bonding this way between positive charge and negative charge, of course, you're gonna get the attraction between the two, okay, which is create the link between them. However, because of this five orbitals of metal, which have electrons in them, okay, the orbital have electrons in them. Ligand is a negatively charged, so that would be the repulsion between lone pairs or ligand and electron in the orbital. And because of this negative charge, ligand will create the splitting of the orbital. This splitting of the orbital depends on the geometry of the complex. Uh-huh. The geometry of the complex, we focus here in this chapter in general chemistry 2. We will look at geometry in this four shape only, linear, where we have metal and two ligand or two coordination number. Tetrahedral, where we have metal and four ligand or four bonds. Okay. Square plana also have four bonds. Octahedral has six bonds. Okay. Because of the position of ligands, position of ligand around metal ion are different, so this would be influence the d orbital differently. So we would look at the shape of d orbitals here. You remember d orbital, we would have the four lobes of electron, high electron density, oriented in the X, Y, Z coordination axis. Like the yz would be on the yz plane. The xz would be on the xz plane. The xy would be on the xy plane. And the high density of electron or the lobe is between the axis. Another two orbital, the x square, y square. This the high electron density would be on the axis, okay? And the dz square, you would have high electron density on the axis. And if you have complex ion in different shape like this, ligand on the linear, or ligand on the octahedral, the position of ligand would have the effects on the d orbital. And we will look at the splitting of d orbital in different geometry, okay? Starting with octahedral complex. The 5 d orbitals in octahedral complex would now separate into two groups depending on how closely the ligand are to the d orbital. On this slide, as you see here, there are two orbitals. There are two orbitals which have the high density electron point directly to ligand. High density electron point directly at ligand. And the three orbitals have high electron density point between ligands. And x, y, y, z, x, z would be grouped together. Z square, x square minus y square will be grouped together. And I will try to make it, well, I hope this is better visualized. So I use the, again, common things that we can find easily, like cotton bud here, and the clay and the tube. So this is the position of ligand. Okay, position of ligand. Where this is the high electron density of the d orbital. The first picture here are the position that you see the high density electron is not close to ligand. Where if you see the x square y square in yellow one here, the lobe or high density electron is actually at the right position to the ligand. When you have ligand and orbital not very close, and ligand and orbital very close, the interaction between them would be different. The direct here would increase the energy of the orbital quite a lot compared to this picture, which is why in octahedral complex ion, the splitting of d orbital would be like in this slide. X, y, y, z, and x, z would be lower energy than z square or x square minus y square, because these two orbitals are on the same axis as ligand. These three orbitals are not very close to the ligand. Okay, and the separation between these two levels of energy is called crystal field splitting, and we use the symbol delta. Okay. Crystal field splitting energy determine the arrangement of electrons in the orbitals. Now hopefully we will get the answer from the very first slide, the difference between Fe hexaequa and Fe hexacyano. These two complex ions must have different arrangement of electrons in orbitals, right? Get back to general chemistry one again. The electron will go into empty orbital before pairing with another electron. This is the Hund's rule. Okay. However, only when the splitting or energy different very high, delta is very high, the electron would have no choice. It will pair with another in the lower energy before going up to the higher energy orbitals. We will see this. Okay. Some of you might still not sure about electron configuration of transition metal ions. So this slide is the review on that topic. This is very important that you know electron configuration of metal ion before. If you don't know electron configuration, you will not know how many electrons that you will arrange into 5d orbitals. So let's review here just a little bit. I cut some part of periodic table of element to put on here with the electron configuration of the atom. For example, scandium would have electron configuration. Don't forget that to write electron configuration, we would have to write in short, the scandium would be argon, 4s2 and 3d1. For titanium, it would be argon, 4s2, 3d2. Okay, so for iron, it would be argon, 4s2, 3d6. You see, 3d6. We count the block 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Of course, as everything in life, we have exception. Chromium is not a default. It is actually 4s1, 3d5. Copper is actually 4s1, 3d10. When you remove electron from a neutral atom, you will remove electron from the highest energy level first, so electron will be taken off from 4s before 3d. So Fe2 would have electron configuration as argon 3d6. Fe3 would have configuration argon 3d5. Cobalt 3d7. So configuration of neutral atom is argon 4s2 3d7. Cobalt 3 take 3 electrons out you would take 2 out and then minus 1 here. So it makes 3d6. Another example, nickel, 3d8. Neutral atom would be argon, 4s2, 3d8. Neon 2, take 2 electrons out, so take from here, so it becomes argon, 3d8. So as shown on this slide, the red color here, 6, 5, 6, 8, are number of electrons in the d orbital. And from now on, we will refer to this type of ion as D6 ion. D6 ion. When you have 5 electrons, we call them D5 ion. When we have 8 electrons, we call them D8 ion. Okay. Now let's see how would we arrange these electrons into 5 orbitals that are now splitting into 2 energy levels. If we have 1 electron in the orbitals, if we have 1 electron in the orbital, we call them D1 now. Okay, D1. The electron will go to lower energy level first, so the electron will be like this. Okay. If we have 2 electrons will go into orbital like this. If we have 3 electrons, 2, 3, okay? And the pattern of filling in electron must be in this way. Now, if we have number 4 electron, where should it go? As I said earlier, electron doesn't want to pair with another, so the electron should go to the higher energy level, like this. However, again, we found that some complex ion would have electron arrangement in this way, 1, 2, 3, and 4 down here. Why it occur like that? You may guess on this right already. It is because of the difference between the 2 levels, right? This one has small delta, where this one has large delta. Okay, this is very simple to think, because as electron doesn't want to pair with another, so if it has a chance, the higher energy is not very high, so it will be going up easily. Where if the energy is very high, so it cannot go up, so it has no choice. The electron must pair down here. All right. So now we have 2 different cases. The first case is called a high spin case. The second case is called a low spin case. This is also very easy to remember. High spin, you would think of electron as it will go high. Low spin, you would think of electron as it will stay low. Okay? High spin, you have small delta, different. Low spin, you have large delta. Okay? The magnitude of the delta, or how small or how large, it actually depends on the 3 factors. Number 1 factor is, of course, because of the charge on metal ion. So the 3 plus charge would be larger delta than a 2 plus charge. And of course, the principal quantum number of the metal, which means the location in the periodic table. So metal on the row number 5 would have larger delta than metal on row number 4 or 3. Okay. However, if you have same metal, same charge, like what we saw earlier for the Fe2, what would make the different crystal field splitting energy is because of the ligand. Again, our complex is, our complex are Fe hexaequa and Fe hexacyano. Different ligand. This would make different magnitude of delta. Follow now. This would make different arrangement, and that would make different magnetic properties. Okay. So if we look at many ligands, and study about the value of the crystal field splitting, we can arrange the ligand like in this slide, starting from carbonyl to iodide. On this side, it is called a strong field ligand. That would make large splitting or large delta. On the right side, it is called weak field ligand, and that will make a small value of delta. What did we have earlier? We compare the cyano and aqua ligand, right? Cyano is strong field. Aqua is weaker field ligand than this. Okay? So Fe hexacyano or Fe hexaequa would have different value of delta. Okay. So again, this slide put together the comparison of small delta or large delta. Small delta caused by weak field ligand. Large delta caused by strong field ligand. The arrangement of electron in these two cases are different. If you have 4 electrons, it will go 1, 2, 3, 4. On the strong field side, the 4 electrons would go 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. And okay, this is the high spin, this is the low spin. Simple trick, high spin, electron goes high, and if you count unpaired electron, you have high number 1, 2, 3, and 4. The low spin, electron stays low. Stay low at lower energy, and if you count number of unpaired electron, you would get low number, only 1 and 2. High or low number of unpaired electron, we only compare the same d ion, high spin, low spin. Okay, let's see for 5 electron or for d5 ion, the electron would go like this. For the low spin. Okay, so if you count number of unpaired electron, the high spin would have 5 unpaired electron, high number. The low spin just have 1 unpaired electron, low number. Okay? Try to picture the arrangement of D6 ion in high spin or low spin. If we write down all the arrangement from D1 to D10, we would get a picture like this. Only D4, D5, D6, and D7 that we have different arrangement in high spin or low spin. Okay? D1, 2, 3, we will have only one type, okay? D1, 2, 3. You cannot make high spin, low spin. Same as D8, 9, 10, you will not have high spin, low spin. Only 4, 5, 6, 7, okay? Now let's try some question. Ion is known to have one unpaired electron. The question is, does the cyano ligand produce a low spin or high spin case? To answer the question like this, to know that the ligand is a low spin or a high spin case, we would have to see how electron in the metal ion, okay, electron in the metal ion are arranged in its 5d orbitals. So first of all, we have to know electron configuration of this ion. Okay. So here it is. The metal ion in this complex is Fe3. How do we know that? Because the complex has 3 minus charge. We have cyano, which is minus 1 charge. How many of them? 6. So x plus 6 minus equal to minus 3, right? X is plus 3. Again, x minus 6 equal to minus 3, x is minus 3 plus 6 mean plus 3. Very simple mathematics. Okay, so remove this for now. Okay, Fe3. Fe3, electron configuration make D5 ion. Again, let's have a look. Why is it D5? Because Fe is here. Don't forget the 4s2. So Fe argon 4s2 3d6. Fe3 remove 3 electrons, 3 electrons from here, 2 minus 1 make D5. All right. Okay. Now we know that this is D5 ion. Try to arrange 5 electron into 5 orbital in low spin and high spin case. we would get a picture like this. This is high spin case. This is low spin case. Remember, high spin, small delta. Low spin, large delta. Small delta, electron goes high. So you would feel 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Low spin, large delta. Low spin, electron stays low. So you would go 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And from the question, this complex ion have one unpaired electron. So this low spin has one unpaired electron. So now we can answer the cyano ligand produce a low spin case. Predict the number of unpaired electrons in the complex ion as shown. Now, we have to look at the spectrochemical series to know if the cyano ligand is a strong or weak field. But first of all, we have to know the oxidation number of the metal ion first. This complex ion, the metal ion is chromium 2. Hopefully you can understand it for now. Again, X cyano 6, H minus 1, so become minus 6 equal minus 4. So X is plus 2. The electron configuration of chromium 2, chromium, remove 2 electrons from 4s and this minus 1, make it d4 ion. So when you have cyano ligand, the cyano ligand is a strong field ligand, so it will make large delta. Large delta produce a low spin. So put 4 electrons in a low spin case, you would go 1, 2, 3, and 4. So the unpaired electron, 2 unpaired electron, 1, 2. Let's move on to tetrahedral complex. The position of ligand and the position of the orbitals of metal ions have different influence or interaction in this case. The d-orbital splitting in tetrahedral complex will be the opposite to that for octahedral. So it will be 3 groups on top, 2 groups below. The xy and xz and yz d orbitals are now closer to the position of ligand than the dz square or dx square minus y square, which make the two of them have lower energy than the other three. And because of the d orbital, none of them are direct pointed to the position of ligand, which means the splitting of the orbital in this case tetrahedral would be smaller than in octahedral. In other words, we would have small delta, which is why in tetrahedral complex we only found high spin case. Okay. So let's see the arrangement of orbitals. Compare between octahedral and tetrahedral complex. Octahedral complex would have higher value of delta than for the tetrahedral complex, and we only have high spin electron go high. So D1 ion electron would go like this. For D2 it would do that. D3, the number 3 electron would go up. 4, 5, then down 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Okay. See it again. Okay. Filling up of electron in tetrahedral complex would be 1, 2, 3, up, 4, 5, down, 6, 7, 8, 9. 10, okay, like this. Only high spin. So it will be simple than the octahedral. Now, if you are asked question like this, give the crystal field diagram for the tetrahedral complex ion of tetrachlorocobalt-2. Okay. Practice to give the name of the complex ion ด้วยนะคะ. So, the metal ion in this complex would be cobalt 2. Electron configuration of the cobalt 2 would be 3d7 ion. Again, from this นะคะ, cobalt remove 2 electron from 4s2, remove electron from here, so make 3d7, move it. Tetrahedral complex, easy, okay. Small delta, 2 orbitals below, 3 orbitals above. Electron would go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. Now we have another two shape of complex to consider. Okay. In the square planar complex, the position of ligands are put onto the x and y axis, which make the interaction of ligands with orbital x square minus y square would be the highest. So this orbital would have the highest energy level, and then the next would be xy, and the other three would all arrange in this pattern, okay? For the linear complex, we put the ligand on the z axis, and the arrangement of splitting would be in this way. Z square would be the highest, xz, yz, and then xy and x square minus y square. These are all the result from the experiment, okay? And it is also found that only low spin complex have been found. Low spin means electron stays low. Remember แล้วนะคะ? Low spin means electron stays low. So the filling up of electron from D1 to D10 in square planar would go like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Okay. The picture on my slide may not fit into the filling up quite well, but just remember that we found only low spin in square planar and linear. So the filling up of electron has to be paired before going up the level. So in linear, it will go the same. Electron stays low. So we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, go up 9 and 10. Okay. So let's practice on what you have learned so far. Now the question, use crystal field theory to describe the d electron distribution of the complexes tetraamine nickel 2 and tetracyanonickelate 2. Tetraamine nickel 2 ion is paramagnetic, where tetracyanonickelate 2 ion is diamagnetic. What would be the electron distribution or the electron configuration in the orbitals of the nickel ion? How do I know that? It has two here and two here, okay? This is all the information that we've got. Tetraamine nickel 2 ion paramagnetic. Tetracyanonickelate 2 ion diamagnetic. So both have nickel 2. So the configuration argon 3d8 ion. Coordination number 4. Both of them. The different, we found different magnetic property, which means they would have different number of unpaired electrons. Which one has unpaired electron? The tetraamine nickel 2 has unpaired electron, where diamagnetic doesn't have unpaired electron. Different number of unpaired electron is from different d orbital splitting, of course, and which means they would have different geometry. So the coordination number 4, we would have two possible geometries. One is square planar, another one is tetrahedral. So let's try to arrange 8 electrons into square planar pattern and tetrahedral pattern. So we're gonna find, so we will get this arrangement of electron. Tetrahedral, remember, two orbitals low energy, three orbitals high energy, and the square planar pattern. Tetrahedral, only high spin, square planar, only low spin. 8 electron would go in tetrahedral like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 electron will go to square planar like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Paramagnetic unpaired electron. Diamagnetic, no unpaired electron. Okay. So the last topic in this chapter, we will look at the color in complex. This is the characteristic of this transition metal complex. The theory about color of object. The object appear as different color because they absorb just certain wavelengths of light and then reflect or transmit other wavelengths of light, which is why we see only the transmitted wavelength. The reflect or transmitted light will enter our eyes and our brain will translate it into the color. Example of color in complex ion, the hexa-aqua titanium 3 here show violet color as you see on this slide. And when we look at the absorbance in different wavelength of light, like shown here, we found that because this complex ion absorb or high absorbance is in this region, which is why the transmitted light would be on this region, and we will see this color. Okay. The reason why complex ion absorb only certain value of wavelength is also related to this d-orbital splitting. For this complex ion that has coordination number 6, so the d splitting would be in octahedral pattern. So we have 3 orbitals with low energy, 2 orbitals with high energy, and the value of this delta is gonna relate to the wavelength of light that is being absorbed. This titanium 3 is d1 ion. So if we have just one electron in these 5 orbitals, when we give energy of light or pass light through this complex, some of the light will be absorbed by this electron, and electron will move up. Electron will move up. This is the wavelength of light that has been absorbed. And this amount, this amount of energy will relate directly to the value of delta. So if you have different value of delta, very small, larger, and largest, so the light that absorb here will have different frequency. Frequency is the opposite relationship to wavelength. So different frequency, different wavelength of light also. And this slide just show you that we see this is the observed color. We see object in different color because the object absorb only certain wavelength, and this wavelength relate to this color. The color is absorbed, so we see the remaining color. And this is the color wheel that when the object absorb this wavelength, we will see the complementary color, the opposite one. If it is absorb 400 nanometer wavelength, we will see it's in the yellow region, you see? Yellow. Okay. Or if it absorb somewhere here, we will see it's in some kind of green or blue. Okay, green or blue. All right. So, what is the wavelength of light that would be absorbed by the object or the complex? It's related to the value of energy splitting, or delta is inversely related to the wavelength. High delta would absorb low wavelength of light. High delta would absorb low wavelength of light. Okay. And we have seen from the crystal field splitting that the value of delta depends on what type of ligand. So we have weak field ligand, we have strong field ligands, which create different value of delta, which means different value of delta, the light that are absorbed would be in different wavelength, which we will see different color. So here is the example of different ligand. In the different complex where we all have chromium 3 or chromium 3 different ligand 6 aqua, 5 aqua, 1 coral, 4 aqua, 2 coral. We see the violet color, blue green color, and green color. Another example, นะคะ. See better here with the color wheel. Compare between the three ligands, ethylene diamine, amine, aqua. Ethylene diamine is a stronger field ligand than amine, stronger than aqua. And we have conclusion that stronger field ligand absorb shorter wavelength light, which is why we will see the complex in green for aqua, in blue for amine, in violet for ethylene diamine. If you look at the color wheel here, นะคะ, we see the aqua in green, we see the green. So the light that is absorbed would be in this region, 650 to 700. We see the amine in blue. We see this color. So the light that are absorbed would be in this region, 580 to 650 nanometer. We see the ethylene diamine complex in violet. We see this color. So the light that are absorbed would be in this region, 560 to 580 nanometer. So stronger field ligand absorb shorter wavelength of light. Okay. And if you are interested, you can go watching some more video that show different color in complex ions. Okay. It's quite fun. Follow the link up here. Okay. So that's it for chapter number 4. And if you cannot follow any part of the lecture, so you can go back and forth and you can pause the video at any time that you want. Please study it yourself. We are at the time of changing the way of teaching and learning. And it's really up to you. Bye bye, นะคะ. See you next video, ค่ะ.